Let's meet the starting lineup. For Villanova, at forward, a 6'7 junior from Mystic, Connecticut, number 21, Harold Presley. For Georgetown, at forward, a 6'7 senior from Washington, D.C., number 24, Bill Martin. For Villanova, at forward, a 6'6 senior from Worcester, Massachusetts, number 33, Wayne McLean. For Georgetown, at forward, a 6'7 sophomore from Baltimore, Maryland, number 34, Reggie Williams. For Villanova, at center, a 6'10 senior from the Bronx, New York, number 54, Ed Pinckney. For Georgetown, at center, a 7-foot senior from Cambridge, Massachusetts, number 33, Patrick Ewing. For Villanova, at guard, a 6'2 junior from Paterson, New Jersey, number 4, Dwight Glover. For Georgetown, at guard, a 6'2 junior from Western Virginia, number 30, Michael Jackson. For Villanova, at guard, a 6-foot senior from Hempstead, New York, number 22, Gary McLean. Georgetown, at guard, a 6'5 junior from Baltimore, Maryland, number 40, David Wingate. And introducing the head coaches, for Villanova, Rolly Massimino, for Georgetown, John Thompson.
The tip-off is next. It's Georgetown and Villanova. Saturday afternoon. As for Villanova, they came in eighth seeded in the Southeast region. They beat Dayton at home and then eliminated Memphis State in the semifinal. These two teams have played each other twice this year. Villanova led both times at the half, but then Patrick Ewing and the Hoyas pulled it out. 52-50 in overtime and 57-50 when the rematch was staged in Landover.
Patrick Ewing got that tap. That ought to be Villanova ball. Good call. Brent, when you look at those scores of Villanova in the NCAA tournament, they have played every game in the 50s. That is their game, so fans ought to keep up with that early. Georgetown starts in a 1-3-1 half-court trap, trying to force Villanova to go faster.
They get a turnover right away off the defense, and they break free with Jackson, but there was a whistle. Gary McLean committed the foul as they came across the timeline.
And if you're John Thompson, that's exactly what you want to do early in this ball game. Create a pace on defense that forces Villanova to push the ball towards the basket. Now defensively for Villanova, they play a zone defense. They match up to where the Georgetown players are, and they play this matchup zone as well as anybody in the country.
After Ewing, Bill Martin, and now it is Jackson, swinging it to David Wingate. Here's Martin. Reggie Williams is 34.
And you can see that Georgetown can take whatever you give them. They're very patient offensively. When it's time to run, they run. When it's time to be patient, they're patient.
Jackson misses, but Williams rebounds, comes back inside, and he pushed off. It's an offensive foul on Williams as he drove toward the glass. He pushed into his man.
That was excellent lockout technique that time by Eddie Pinckney, but what happened to him, he was blocking out so much, nobody picked up Williams.
Full court pressure right away by the Hoyas.
Villanova does a good job beating man-to-man pressure because McLean really protects the ball. Now there's the 1-3-1 defense on the part of Georgetown.
Unusual because Ewing comes out in this defense with Martin lurking in behind. Wayne McLean into the corner and Wilbur. They trap, but Wilbur comes to Eddie Pinckney. Pinckney lost control, but got it to Harold Presley, who put it in. It didn't look pretty, but it counts.
And why that was so effective is Eddie Pinckney took it right at Patrick Ewing to occupy the space. Ewing has such great leaping ability that unless you take the ball to him, he'll cover 2 men at one time.
Pinckney has been bothered the last few days by the flu. When I was over here at the Villanova practice earlier today, he worked early, then sat down for a while, but said he'd be fine tonight. Cross court court to Jackson.
That zone is basically 2-3, but then they match up.
Win game.
Off balance, still hit the shot. Great body control. For those that don't see a lot of basketball, that is legal to step out of bounds and throw it the first pass over.
Trying to get it into Presley. Kicked. And the ball remains in the possession of the Wildcats.
Georgetown can show zone defenses, man-to-man defenses, trapping defenses. They do a little bit of everything.
Wayne McLean, 33, swings it back to Garrett. Spelled differently. Wilbur getting it to Dwayne, who comes inside, and they're challenging the big fella early.
Now, here you see the tandem defense. Two players playing behind each other, and then they'll drop back in kind of a 2-3 alignment.
Wingate. He hits his first two. McLean gets it up against that pressure, protecting the ball.
Nine! Georgetown now playing man-to-man defense. As I said, they really switch things around. Look for Villanova to try to get the ball to Eddie Pinckney. This defense helps Villanova because they can go ahead and take their time.
Pinckney ships it over to Gary McLean. Inside, and remember, he's a great streak shooter, and he made a brilliant move to get inside pressure that time.
Sensational shot because the defense on McLean was perfect.
Cross court, Williams. And again, what they've practiced to bring the ball inbound against that Hoya pressure. Pinckney, ball out, puts it down, and he travels, and it's over to Georgetown.
Nice clear out for Gary McLean.
Against the pressure, he gets it up, but he traveled. He made that spinning move against the trap, and Jackson says something right in Gary McLean's face.
And that, again, was a different look by Georgetown. They double-teamed with their guards that time and made it tough for McLean.
Timeout, Georgetown with a four-point lead. 14:54 left in the first half. 50-year-old Roland Vincent Massimino. In his 12th year at Villanova, played college basketball in Vermont, where he was a reserve guard. Later went on to become a high school coach, then moved to Stony Brook College on Long Island, was an assistant at Penn, was hired by Villanova, and has been a success there ever since. An ideal man for that program. Villanova is perfect shooting from the floor, but they have committed four turnovers against that Georgetown pressure already. Inside to Wingate. Oh, Ewing got up in the air, was off balance. All right. Harold Jensen has checked into the game for Villanova, number 32.
Credit Eddie Pinckney again. He did not get the rebound, but terrific block out on Patrick Ewing so that Patrick couldn't get position.
This is Harold Jensen.
Jensen, the big star in the North Carolina win. Dwight Wilbur has just not been able to get in the game in the NCAA playoffs.
So difficult to get your shot against Georgetown. McLean comes up and he's been banging away. He's carrying him offensively with those three field goals already.
You notice how well Villanova gets back on defense. It's very difficult to get fast breaks against them. Their transition from offense to defense is great.
Williams, double team. Presley goes for the loose ball off Williams out of bounds. And it goes over. Great play by Harold Presley.
I thought Jensen pulled Williams' arm on that play and got away with a foul. Williams doesn't look strong, but he's awful wiry.
Villanova can tie at this trip.
Wayne McLean looks like he wants to take one again.
They will want to get Jensen into the game if they can. Dumps it off to Pinckney. Maneuvering on Ewing. Missed. Snapped down by Martin. Jackson comes inside. Great pass. They hit David Wingate, who's come down the baseline.
Well, you can't appreciate what a great catch that was by Wingate. Has a body flying right over his head and still pulls it in.
They're stationing Pinckney out away from the basket. Here's Jensen's first shot, and he's on the money. He's a key man for Nova to protect. Will this pressure wear down Villanova? They are not as deep as Georgetown. Pinckney rushes for the loose ball, puts it down, comes inside, gets it to Presley, and Ewing came back, but Presley hit it.
You notice Patrick Ewing came about 25 feet on that pass, almost got there in time, but good play by Eddie Pinckney. The score a little higher than Raleigh Massimino would like, but if you look up there, we're under 10 minutes now, 18-14.
And Reggie Williams is just dead-eye from that corner. He has hit his four shots in this game so far. Remember, he came off the bench in last year's championship against Houston and won the MVP by scoring 19 points. And there, Martin, another of the seniors, knocks the ball out of bounds. And here comes a freshman, Harry McDonald. We've got a timeout. But already, John Thompson is starting to go to his bench. And we'll see that Hoya depth when you come back. Shots. Michael Jackson handed out 11 assists. Already here tonight, he has four. This was the prettiest. Wingate cut it behind, worked down the baseline, and hit the
field. A game and a quarter. Here's the trap again.
As Billy pointed out, the points are starting to mount up, and Massimino prefers a lower scoring game than what he's in right now.
Matter of fact, I think Villanova would be smart to pull it out a while.
Wayne McLean drew the foul from Martin.
But when you look at the score, and we said this is the top of the show, you multiply Georgetown's total now times four, and you're talking about an 80-point type game. In an 80-point type game, Villanova cannot win. They have to slow this pace down a little bit. And the way it looks, they're going to have to do it on offense.
You know, this game is being seen around the world via satellite by our servicemen and women through the Armed Forces television service tonight. Also being heard on radio. And I understand I mentioned earlier, Big John Pannone is playing basketball over in Spain. He's watching tonight. His brother Steve, of course. He sits on the bench over there for Raleigh Massimino, and he certainly wanted to send along his best to his brother and hope he's enjoying it at the early hour in the morning over there.
Continues to hit. Villanova picks up full court. Georgetown blows right by him.
With that great quickness. And here's McDonald. Pinckney rebounds.
And here's where Villanova cannot afford to get in a run shoot game. Pull it back out. Try to slow this game down a little.
Jackson with Jensen there. Better than normal against this tough defense. Stolen by Wingate, but he can't run it down after he tapped the ball. Gary McLean sealed him off. And Wingate is so quick defensively, he always gets his hand in on the basketball.
Good point, Brennan. John Wooden always said it's hard to teach quickness. That's what he tried to recruit, was quickness. If he had to take one particular asset of a player, and you saw Wingate go almost 18 feet there to knock that ball out of the way.
Brodnax is number 32, who just checked in. Jackson sits down.
Now obviously, Georgetown, a big, big advantage on that bench. Villanova will have to go primarily with these five players plus one sub. The zone changes again.
Jensen gets it to McLean. He'll come up on Ewing. Ewing sprawling to the ground, trying to draw the offensive foul. And I'll tell you, they have been more successful inside against Ewing than any team I've seen in the tournament to date, and that includes Georgia Tech.
I think the reason for that, Eddie Pinckney may be the quickest big man in the country in terms of getting the ball in the lane and turning on a guy like Patrick. Normally, Patrick Ewing is the man that has the quickness advantage.
traveling on the turnover. He double dribbles.
John Thompson coming back with a substitute. McDonald, an outstanding player, very gifted, but doesn't have the experience in a game like this one.
It is so important against Georgetown not to let them get that early big lead. Villanova can tie the game at 20 this trip.
He's got to watch the trap. We're talking about a team with three seniors that have been in the wars a lot.
McLean with a spinning move is tied it at 20.
A hot night through Butter
and
gets
a rebound.
Comes back with the steal.
That's a sensational turnaround. Villanova in a position to take a two-point lead, finds himself two down. A four-point turnaround on Williams' effort.
Puts it on the floor, gets inside the defense. It goes over. Williams and Wingate got a little too close, and Roy's saying he traveled when he put it down. That's what he was protesting that time for the official.
Part of that is working the official. Now Villanova trying to force tempo too much. There's no hurry there.
Ewing is going to return.
Patrick wants to get in the game so bad he just knocked over half the score. That was some block by Presley. Now Presley on Saturday had a 1-for-8 game, and we both thought he played a sensational basketball. That's why.
Coach Massimino moved Gary McLean in just to Williams' right, but he can't get over to seal him off. Williams comes through, and he's got the field goal.
That was just poor execution, Brent. You've got to move as soon as that ball is released out there. You've got to move over there and get in the way of the shooter. You've got to block him out.
Billy, you pointed out the score. We've got another 5 minutes, and Georgetown has only scored 2 points since that 9:52 mark.
That's right. Now we're getting back into a situation where you look at the score and you say, hey, it swung back to the tempo that Villanova wants. At the 10-minute mark, Georgetown had 20 points. That's an 80-point game. Now it looks like we're getting back down to a 60-point game.
Dalton and Ewing together on the floor.
Now you notice Presley that time did not go down in the corner. That was the wise thing to do. Great man-to-man by Georgetown.
Ewing coming over on Pinckney, and Jackson has possession. Marvelous defense. Jackson trying to come through, though. Ewing almost crashing to the floor for the loose ball.
Patrick Ewing, that's why he's such a super player. He runs 80 feet, dives for the loose ball. No prima donna there. I thought he committed a foul, but got away with it. But still, what an effort.
Takes the inbounds pass. Shakes Jensen, off Jensen.
Jensen gets away from those elbows.
Wingate. It'll be short. Pinckney rebounding.
Wise move by Eddie Pinckney. There was a semi-fast break there, but Villanova doesn't want a fast break. Eddie just wants to walk down the court. Very smart. That's the key to this club. We're talking about a senior team here.
Ewing trying to keep Pinckney from coming through the baseline, and he was effective defensively inside.
They'd like to get the ball to Eddie Pinckney.
They did it behind Ewing, and he was fouled. Williams coming back. That's his second personal.
Now, there's a lot to that defense. Great weak side defense here by Williams, recognizing that Patrick Ewing's out of place. The other thing that's the key here, Brent, is that the Georgetown teammates don't want anybody to dunk on Patrick Ewing. And you watch Williams come across here. He makes sure there was no dunk on that play.
You know, there is a sad note surrounding the Villanova team. Al Severance passing away back in Philadelphia this morning. Raleigh Massimino telling me that he was Villanova basketball. He coached his team for 25 years, and at the first Final Four in 1939, Coach Severance took Villanova into the semis and lost to Ohio State. That was played up Northwestern in Evanston, Illinois.
Brett, during his days, they were the cradle coaches there. You had Ramsey and McCluskey, Judy Moore, Harry Litwack, and them great coaches during that period of time in Philadelphia.
Ewing got his position. They won't stop that. That's where Thompson wants him, down low.
And John smiled on that one. And here comes a full-court zone trap. Great pass. and a turnover by Presley that's not called. Sensational pass by Eddie Pinkney.
Maybe he does play better, sir.
Presley comes inside, gets the high.
Got the roll.
Everything.
The half. A great move by Raleigh Massimino. Because he has Eddie Pinkney on the bench, and he does not want to do this. Now, Georgetown will counter with a 1-3-1 trap. They will not let him hold it.
John positioning his players defensively, keeping them back in that zone alignment that you see. And what you are watching again is a relic. Almost everyone agrees that they'll go to the 45-second shot clock next year in this tournament.
I think John Thompson's had a great year coaching his club, but right now I don't know why he would allow Villanova to hold the ball. This really plays into Raleigh Massimino's hands. He's got to go out and chase him. Now, he's asking for a warning by the referee, but as long as Villanova throws the ball past that white hash mark, they are not in violation.
You can see Dwayne McLean standing just inside the hash mark on your screen, and Jensen is just inside it. You can see them playing catch right there, so no warning will be given.
And I think Georgetown should come out for another reason. They're not in the one-and-one yet. They can come out and aggressively attack Villanova, and even if they foul, Villanova doesn't get any foul shots. Raleigh Massimino has to be so happy now that he's getting by with this strategy. Kind of amazing.
Georgetown leading by 1 point. And the clock running down here in the first half of this NCAA championship game in Lexington, Kentucky. I'm Brent Musburger with Billy Packer, and we certainly hope you're enjoying this one.
Georgetown goes man-to-man, and again, I can't understand why they allow Villanova to hold this ball.
Now they get it inside to Presley. He comes inside on Ewing. It wouldn't stay, but he comes back with the rebound. They went right at the big fella. Wingate comes free for the jump shot, but time has expired. And Villanova, for the third time this year, has taken the lead, and we had a little bit of a scrape underneath the basket at the end of the first half. Massimino is furious.
Massimino lead his troops back to the locker room, and Thompson say, what's going on here?
All right, there's the shot by Wingate. Actually, the half ended right here. Emerson goes. Williams goes after him. A good no call by the referee. You have to call that a double foul or a no call, and it was a no call. I think a critical mistake by John Thompson at the end of the half. You've got Pinkney on the bench. You've got to go after him.
All right, let's go upstairs to Dick Stockton, Dick.
Well, maybe the coronation is going to have to be delayed a little because the Villanova Wildcats, who are down by 6 points, came back and lead 29-28. We'll have videotape highlights and a lot more coming up after this commercial message and this word from your local station on CBS. Welcome back to Rupp Arena, and there is a star of last year's Georgetown National Championship effort, the great defensive player Gene Smith, who's now an alum and one of the many greats who has played for Georgetown. But the Hoyas find themselves in a battle at halftime, and in fact, for the third time this year, Villanova has the lead over Georgetown at the half. 29-28 is our score, and the amazing statistic thus far is the fact that Villanova has shot 72% in the first half, 52% for Georgetown, and they have weathered a Patrick Ewing storm. Well, it's been a terrific week in Lexington, Kentucky, one of the smallest cities ever to host a Final Four, Greensboro being the other smallest, and they really rolled out the red carpet. Not a big dome stadium, but Rupp Arena, certainly a more intimate setting, the home of the University of Kentucky, where Adolph Rupp dominated for so many years as a great coach. Part of the magic of the NCAA tournament is that it brings together teams, fans, and the media from around the U.S., and when the Final Four hits town, people's images and impressions are bound to change.
Lexington is a one-horse town in which the sounds of the village blacksmith summed up the entire city. But as visitors arrived this week, they discovered that Lexington's charms are hard to refuse. I can hear Kentucky calling me. Holding the NCAA tournament in a basketball-crazed town like Lexington just added fuel to the fire. If it said Final Four on it, people bought it. And when they weren't buying, there were carriage rides to show off the countryside the natives are so proud of.
This is the most hospitable place there was ever at, in every way, shape, or form.
The teams weren't overlooked, receiving their share of bluegrass hospitality. The public practice let fans and players get acquainted with each other. And while some watched in awe, others sought out autographs. Meanwhile, the coaches in town for their convention also had a chance to relax.
Most coaches' golf swings would make you vomit.
The strangest event all week took place on the Kentucky campus. On the same backboards, Coach Rupp's team helped make famous. Students created Final Four art using paint, a ball, and a strong imagination. You wonder just what the Baron would have thought.
He would have changed the name of the Fabulous Five to the Filthy Five if this had occurred back in his days.
Final Four week in Lexington, Kentucky, and we'll be back with more, plus videotape highlights of the first half when we continue in the national championship game in just a moment.
At next year's NCAA Final Four. Tickets to the 1986 championship are $46, which includes admission to the semifinals and final game in Dallas. Send your name, address, and phone number along with the cashier's check or money order to NCAA Final Four, United Missouri Bank of Kansas City. Post Office Box 1986, Kansas City, Missouri 64141. Not more than four tickets per order, please. Your application must be received by April 15th.
The preceding message was provided by the NCAA.
It's great to have friends and teammates to support you, but friends who want you to get high or get drunk are not friends at all. Drugs are not going to help you through the tough times or make the good times any better. Drugs prevent you from being your best. Please feel free to turn to others around you. Talk to your coach, your parents, or school counselors and get the support that you need. Don't let drugs make a loser out of you.
The preceding message provided by the NCAA. Final Four program. This feature-packed magazine will be a collector's item for years to come. Send a check or money order for $6 to NCAA Program, Box 1985A, Lexington, Kentucky, 405.
We are back, about ready to start the second half. Billy, I want to go back in on that controversy. We have another angle now showing how Williams teed off on Everson down here. Watch the referee in the background. He's watching it all the way. Williams comes up with his arms right there, much like an offensive tackle trying to ward off the charge of a defensive end, hit him high. I think a foul should have been called.
Well, very possibly. What I think happened to Williams is that he felt Everson with a block out of the hip, and he turned around and retaliated. But he doesn't have any excuse for doing that. And if you're on top of that official, I have to agree with you, Ben. I think you've got to...
After this commercial and a word from your local station, call a personal because they thought that it was not intentional and not flagrant. Molly Massimino disagreeing with that. Rutledge is one of the referees along with John Fogarty and Bob Diebler. They are working this national championship game. And what a surprise. Georgetown trailing, but remember in their two previous meetings, Villanova led each time at the half and the Hoyas came back to win it. Ewing. Georgetown regains the lead that quickly.
That was a great shot by Patrick Ewing because Eddie Pinckney thought he had it timed perfectly. Dangerous pass. You notice this is what makes it so tough on Georgetown to force Villanova. Villanova just gets the ball over half court. They don't worry about attacking against it. Very patient. Some teams try to take it down into Patrick Ewing, and that's when they get in trouble and turn it into a pace game.
Gary McClain with Michael Jackson on him. Presley, double team, ships it out to McClain.
McClain got pushed.
Pinckney to Harold Jensen from the perimeter, rattles in. Jensen is now 3 of 3 off the Villanova bench. That's why he's starting the second half. Martin. Wingate. Pinckney has it. Delivered to him on the errant pass, and this will be Dwayne McClain. And Georgetown retreats. They're going to let Villanova bring it up.
Well, they have a hard time setting up that press. There you see that field goal percentage. Georgetown, not only during the NCAA tournament, but throughout the course of the year, held their opponents under 39% free throw shooting. No place for McClain to go, so he pulls it out. A time of possession for Villanova. They started getting what they wanted at the end of the second half.
You
you pointing out that Thompson may have made a tactical error by letting Villanova pull it out.
Oh!
The field goal and drew the foul. Eddie Pinckney this year has had 288 field goals, 256 fouls. Now watch this move. And you're talking about getting that shot off, being guarded by the best man in college basketball defensively. Patrick didn't like the call. Only his first personal foul. But you know, you get the feeling everything Villanova throws up there seems to go in. Great touch.
The first half of this game was as good a half of college basketball as I've ever seen. We'll see what unfolds here in the second half.
Eddie's a 72% free throw shooter, so solid on there. And John Thompson wants a timeout already. Very unusual timeout.
...1985 National Championship Game between the Villanova Wildcats and the Georgetown Hoyas is sponsored by Bud Light. A light beer with a taste that's satisfying but never bitter. And by Renault, introducing 550 plus protection. The one to watch, Renault.
Frequently in this NCAA tournament, John Thompson and the Hoyas have blown teams out early in the second half. It is always a critical part of the game against this team.
Triple team.
Hoyas keep it.
There was Patrick Ewing caught in the lane with three men around him. There had to be somebody open.
Martin, short. He skies for the rebound.
That's a lucky break for Villanova. They weren't set in their defense, and Georgetown almost caught him napping. Eddie Pinckney starting to set outside now, drawing Patrick Ewing way out. That opens up a good drive for Wayne McLean.
Jensen to the top.
Can't pick up your dribble like that if you're Jensen. Now Eddie Pinckney waves to McLean, says get the ball back outside again, and we're getting back to Villanova's pace of this game. This is not a delay game Villanova's playing. They're looking for an opening, just as Georgetown's playing solid defense here. Most teams would crack under this pressure.
Pinckney comes outside, ships it to Gary McLean. Out of bounds.
Great help by Gary McLean. Willie Martin had an easy jump shot there. Villanova zone's now starting to pack inside 10 feet.
Williams was fouled after he took that pass, and that is the first foul on Dwayne McLean. And at the reminder that at the conclusion of our championship game tonight, Billy and I will select a Chevrolet Most Valuable Player for each team. Chevrolet, of course, donates a $1,000 scholarship to the General Scholarship Fund of both schools.
But the jump shot's there for Jackson. He's just not looking to take it.
Ewing, short, hanging with him. And that on Ewing is the second foul.
If we see that one, Trent, Eddie Pinckney, instead of trying to challenge Patrick Ewing on the shot, watch him. He'll use his body on Ewing so Ewing can't get position. Great defensive play by Eddie Pinckney. Now Georgetown starting to pick up three-quarter court.
Offensive foul on Jensen. Williams threw the charge that time.
Pretty good Hollywood act by Williams. You'll notice here, Jensen makes his move. As soon as Williams felt the contact, he went down. Now, you couldn't knock a man down standing up like that if you ran over him with a truck. Good Hollywood job. Pulling. Now, Presley made that super scoop shot in Saturday's game. Patrick picks up his third. We'll probably see Ralph Dalton. It's a great catch by McLean right here. Presley goes in. Patrick Ewing got him with the body.
Here's Dalton into the game. He'll replace Ewing, who sits down at the 15:09 mark. And Ewing picks up those three fouls in 51 seconds of play. He went to the locker room at halftime without a single foul.
And here comes our experience on the foul line. Presley, he either hits them clean or throws up the bricks. On the year, only shooting 64% from the foul line.
Now what Massimino and Villanova have to be careful of is a letdown with Ewing over here on the bench. We saw Georgetown pick it up with Dalton on the floor against Georgia Tech, for example.
Comes in to give excellent performance, hitting those two foul shots. Hard for McLean. He's going to receive a double team here. Nice job with the crossover dribble. McLean is so smart. You know, he's been in these Big East wars for 4 years. Dalton can't handle Pinckney outside. Pinckney will go by him.
Jensen travels.
Raleigh Massimino upset with Jensen, saying, on what basis are you going to dribble the ball in that lane anyway? And he's going to talk to Jensen on the sideline.
Ewing returning with those three.
He'll eventually get the jump shot. You notice how the tempo picks up when Georgetown goes into those double teams on defense. Hard to go ahead and pull the ball back out.
Ewing jumps out. He covers more floor space than any center of recent memory. Somewhat like Bill Russell jumping out on everybody. Coming inside.
That's it.
That's it. Jackson fouled. Dwayne McLean put it down and came in for the hoop.
This basket's got to count.
Yes, sir.
There goes McLean. He's in the air. Excellent call by the official. You've got to establish defensive position early, and it didn't take place. That was some shot. McLean could do no wrong to the Final Four.
That time, they took advantage of Ewing being outside in that zone, and McLean put it down and went to the hole.
Exactly right, Brent. When Pinckney goes out, Patrick Ewing has to go out there with him because he's so quick and can handle the ball, and that opens up the baseline.
That's one of the new plays they worked hard on this morning in practice.
And McLean keeps up his incredible performance here in the Final Four. Hadn't missed a free throw yet.
Jackson. Long. Martin crashed into by Presley. And that is Presley's first.
There's a case of Presley just happened to be in the wrong place at the wrong time. Billy Martin crashing the boards here as Jackson threw up a brick. Came bounding off of there. Billy Martin comes over. Presley just happened to get there a little too late. Ball is being knocked away from the basket by Georgetown. That allows them to set up their defense. Referee has to warn him there to leave that ball alone.
Villanova has kept up its incredible shooting. 4-4 here in the second half. They are 77%, and Jackson has just picked up his second. And that is the 16th foul against Georgetown, 4 against Villanova. We're at the 12:58 mark here in the second half.
And Villanova, an excellent free throw shooting team. On the year, they made within 10 free throws of what their opponent shot all year. So they go to the foul line a lot. Gary McLean really understands where those trap defenses are coming, and he's very patient with the ball.
Jensen wanted it inside, and Brodnack simply took it away from him.
That's a bad judgment by Jensen.
Wingate, and charging on Grodnax, and oh, Gary McLean took a blow in the head area. Gary McLean is down.
There's no way he's going to be down long. He won't keep him out of this game. He'll be up. There was a case where Grodnax just took it one dribble too far. He's up. He's not going anywhere. You could take him out of the game. Here you see Grodnax. One dribble too many, then goes in the air. Good job by McLean, and you'll see him snap that head down there. He's all right. Now, that manager should stay out of the way, because Raleigh Massimino doesn't want to have to take a timeout.
Meanwhile, the Hoyas have circled around John Thompson.
Now, see, Raleigh Massimino said, I don't want the timeout, and I'm not taking him out. You fellas stopped the game. My man was ready to play, and now Raleigh's going to lose his case, and they're going to charge him with a timeout, I think. Now, Raleigh doesn't want to use the timeout, so he'll quickly, great move on his part, he'll quickly get a replacement in for McLean so that he doesn't have to use the timeout. He wants to save it to the end of the game. He's not missing a trick.
And, of course, that was not a player control foul, so Blansky has to come in here and shoot the free throws. It's a one-and-one, and Blansky's coming off the bench right away to the free throw line. The reason he selected Blansky, of course, is that's his best shooter. If he wanted a ball handler, he would have gone to Wilbur.
Well, Wilbur's a 75% free throw shooter. Blansky just 57, but Blansky is a field shooter from the outside. I think I might have gone with experience there. We'll see how it works out.
Gave it to Jackson. Quickly, Wingate lost it. Jackson runs it down. Pinckney blocks the ball out of bounds. He seals up that baseline.
That baseline is not going to be open because, as you pointed out, Pinckney's just filling the lane. The jump shots are available for Jackson and Broadnax. They're just not putting them up right now.
You saw McLean, of course, re-enter the game, and Plansky is out. Stolen by Villanova.
They can keep it in the 60s at the rate we're going. Maybe the 50s.
Martin on the turnaround. Villanova leading by a point.
Nice move with that left hand by McLean. For young players, they ought to notice how he can handle the ball both with his right and left hand. So no matter what they throw at him defensively, he can handle it. Really a fine point guard. Jensen's the one player that doesn't have the experience and sometimes gets into trouble by picking up his dribble.
Pinckney far outside in the corner. So he brings Ewing out with him. Ewing rejected it.
Ewing on the
lob. Ewing on the lob. Missed, lost control. Presley rebound.
And again, good judgment by Presley. Not to force the fast break. Slow the game down.
The Hoyas were looking for the big play to put them ahead at that moment.
Clear out for Presley. Again, good judgment.
McLean wanted to get the ball to Pinckney. Hit by the Hoyas. Reggie Williams over there. So Villanova keeps possession.
You wonder if fatigue is going to be a problem, Brent. This game has been very fast-paced from a standpoint of emotional energy, even though there's not a lot of scoring.
There is no doubt that Williams' ankle is bothering him. They've just taken him out again now, and Grodnax has gone into the game for Coach Thompson.
Presley had McLean. He just couldn't get him the ball.
Wingate knocks the ball out of bounds. Villanova retains possession. Here is Williams going back over to the bench. The ankle was sprained against Loyola, and he has been limping somewhat ever since. Now the open man, Dwayne McLean, comes up.
Big call there. keep his dribble alive. Raleigh Nassimino now wants to use one of those timeouts.
Gary McLean, the shot's there, on its way. Villanova regains the lead.
McLean pounds that fist and looks over at his coach. Hard to take it away from seniors. They notice the last time they'll play in a collegiate game, and they put it all together.
Wingate. Martin came up. Was fouled underneath by Pinkney. That's his third personal.
One of the few times tonight that Villanova has not got a good lockout position on the weak side. Court pressure. And McLean tells Jensen to get out of the way. He feels he can bring it up on Jackson one-on-one, and he needs a clear out there by his teammate.
Jensen.
Oh, he is just filling it up. That's one of those Raleigh Nassimino probably said, no, 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 yes, yes, yes. Not letting Patrick Ewing touch the ball in low, so that means jump shots are available.
Wingate.
That pass coming in. That's one of the few times I've seen Patrick Ewing look like he's a little tired. He may have to come out here for the rest.
Rodmax fouling.
You notice Patrick Ewing down in the lane, Brent. One more.
Great maneuver inside.
Tired. That's twice in all, Kent, that Eddie Pinkney was able to get good position, and that doesn't happen to Ewing often. Starting to take this game very seriously. He said they get serious when the mallet goes down. Well, this mallet has been down since the tap. Oh, that's a walk by Jackson. Got by with it.
Wingate. Franklin rebound.
Brent, do you sense that Georgetown starting to tighten up a little bit on that jump shot? They stay with the man-to-man, and that field goal shooting percentage is unbelievable.
Unbelievable by Villanova.
Pinckney gets inside.
He wants to get away with it anyway. Now Thompson's got to go timeout here. And he's going to call one. He's got to.
Possession.
Now this has been the key of the game. You can remember in the first half when the game was swinging Georgetown's way, actually they had the ball in their possession more than Villanova. But in this half, you can see Villanova doubling the time of possession. They're controlling the ball. It's their pace of the game. And for Georgetown now, they have to start looking at that clock a little bit, realizing they're behind, and that's when that jump shot is hard to get out of your hand. That rest ought to help Patrick Ewing. He'll be much more active on the board. Raleigh Nassimino using every second of that timeout. His players have been out there. Let's see, Brent. Jensen is a sub, but Pinckney has not been out of the game. McLean, Dwayne McLean has not been out of the game, and Presley has not been out of the game. And Gary McLean was only out for a second or two, so he's got four fellas that have gone all the distance.
And again, Williams sitting down, and I suspect it is that ankle that has been bothering him considerably here tonight. Rodnax on the floor for the Hoyas as possession moves it to Jackson.
They're wanting to go inside, but the jump shot's what they got to take. There it is. That shows you some guts when a man will take that shot when it's available, even under this tight situation. They're waiting for Gary McLean to come back and take this ball away.
They get it to Jensen. They go to the top in the corner. He's got to come free. And they've lost it. It goes to the Hoyas, and now they can pull 5:09 to play in regulation. These two teams have been overtime once this year.
5 seconds. You must get the ball inbounds in 5 seconds, and that's not when it leaves your hand as a passer. That's when it touches another player inbounds. Jensen upset, and the senior leadership calming him down a little bit. Better get the ball to Gary McLean again. Georgetown pulls their defense back in a little tighter now. Trying to go to Pinckney in there on Ewing. Great man-to-man by Georgetown.
They get it inside to Pinckney. He comes up on Ewing. Lost control.
Wally got exactly what he wanted. He better calm down. He cannot afford a technical foul here.
In this NCAA championship game, Georgetown leading by a point right now. That's the timeouts remaining. Thompson and Massimino each with two. As for that possession arrow in case of a jump ball right now, well, it is pointing in the direction of Villanova, even though that official is blocking it. As for the foul trouble, McLean and Pinckney with three for Villanova. Ewing and Wingate with three. There's a clean shot. Pointing right, Wally Massimino, who has done another splendid job of bench coaching here tonight in this championship game, coming in as a heavy underdog.
For those millions of fans that are watching their one basketball game of the year, that possession arrow means if there's a jump ball situation, the ball goes over to the team that is pointing towards their goal, and that would be Villanova. Georgetown goes back in his zone. I think this favors Villanova again because they'd like some more time to go off that clock without pressure. I think Raleigh Nassimino likes it too. He'll take another minute and a half off the clock looking for a good shot. Oh.
Jensen puts Villanova ahead at the 235 mark.
Ice water in his veins. They gave him the shot.
And that is four on Wingate.
That David Wingate's been getting by going to baseline. What he really wants to do when he drives in there is pass that ball off to Patrick Ewing. But the Villanova defense is all shifting down in there, putting four men in the lane, and there's no place to go.
Here's Pinckney with the one and one.
Eddie's been standing on that foul line a long time. He ought to move off of that to get himself a little more relaxed. 72%.
Williams will try it again on that tender ankle. And Brodnix will sit down.
Corners now.
Jensen is fouled by Jackson. We'll shoot one and one. This would be one of the greatest upsets in the history of championship games at the NCAA tournament. Brodnix and a quick timeout after the field goal. While Jensen was shooting, Reggie Williams again had to leave the game because of that injured ankle. Villanova ahead by three with a minute 15 left in regulation. And whom do you foul down the stretch of this game?
Well, we've said that Villanova is an excellent free throw shooting team. And you'll notice that Presley at 64%, and the man that's been very uncertain from the foul line, a guy that sometimes swishes but sometimes throws air balls.
As for Georgetown.
Well, in the case of Georgetown, if they have an Achilles heel, it is free throw shooting. There you see Jackson the best on there. So they've got a lot of fellas you can attack, percentage-wise.
This is the last college game for Patrick Ewing at Georgetown. The end of an era. Three times in 4 years, he has brought him to the title game. And for Ed Pinckney, his last game, they've dueled each other for 4 years.
Nobody guarding the man taking the ball out of bounds. Now what happened? Brodnix tried to pull Presley down, which he did. Jensen gets fouled. Now Presley's hurt. What happened is Brodnix pulled him to the ground trying to draw a charge. Presley went down very hard. It's a trick a lot of people try to use. They don't guard the man taking the ball out of bounds and try to draw the charge. We'll see it right here. Now watch it. You'll see Brodnix pull him to the ground. It should have been a foul on Brodnix. Really a dirty play. Just a plain dirty play. I mean, that was one thing to play hard. That's a dirty play.
He took a knee in the groin area, and that's why he was shaken up. He comes back now down to the free throw line. Jensen, who has come off the bench. He's 5 of 5 from the field in this game. And he's perfect from the free throw line. He's 3 of 3.
Nothing but net.
Now 1:10 remaining.
A little uncertainty by Georgetown.
Ewing. McLean rebounding inside of a minute through the foul. And Villanova with a chance to stage one of the greatest upsets in the history of the NCAA championship finals.
They're starting to celebrate a little bit, and if I was the Villanova players, considering their competition, they better get down there and stay all serious. Eddie Pinkney doing a little slap and five. There's a lot to play yet.
Turned it over. And right away, Georgetown commits the foul.
It's going to be Jensen back on that foul line, Brandon. You talk about a bench player. They are ecstatic. That's Raleigh's son right there shaking hands with everybody. He can't believe it either.
How tough it is to repeat, huh? Harold Jensen coming to the free throw line. He's a sophomore out of Trumbull, Connecticut. He was somewhat of a disappointment as a freshman for Coach Massimino. Even earlier this year, he wasn't certain how much play he'd get out of it. But here in the NCAA tournament, he has suddenly become a shooting hero. That's his first miss, and it was a big one. 61-56, but the Hoyas will have to hurry. Reggie Williams is back. Ewing rams it in.
Georgetown wants another timeout, and they get it. Big misses on that free throw line. That's two straight, one and one.
That was Georgetown's last timeout. Raleigh Massimino has two left against John Thompson.
John's trying to say who called the timeout. The man that called the timeout was Gardnack. He doesn't want the timeout, but it was called legitimately. Bet those free throws have kept Villanova on the mark all game. They started celebrating with a 5-point lead and on the line. They've now missed the front of the two straight one and one. Those are nails on the coffin if you can put them in there.
So that timeout call by Brodnax is costly. Possession arrow still pointing towards Villanova if there's a jump ball. The man who has to be absolutely overjoyed is there behind Canone, the longtime trainer, Jack Nevin. Been confined to a wheelchair, suffering from Lou Gehrig's disease.
There's a movement underway to name their new field house at Villanova after Jake.
And at the other end on the Georgetown bench, that's Mary Penland, the academic advisor, the first person John Thompson ever hired. One of the great things about this game that I want to mention with 41 seconds to go, we have two schools with high-class programs right here. John Thompson has graduated 44 of 46 men who've reached the senior class. Wally Massimino, he is 38 of 38. These two schools did not cheat to get here tonight. They did it through hard work. I'm Brent Musburger along with Billy Packer. We're in the Rupp Arena in Lexington, Kentucky. There's 41 seconds to go. Georgetown trying to win its second straight national championship. Villanova trying to deny them. Ewing's fourth personal foul.
And again, only 2 seconds went off the clock, so 39 seconds with the fouling that you can do. can really stall this game the rest of the way. Now, that's been one of the big things talked about here at the National Convention. What type of penalty to put into the game of basketball to prevent this from taking place? A lot of people are advocating that the team that's fouled ought to have the right to take the ball out of bounds since the foul no longer can be done to stop the game. As we say at the top of the show, the clock will come in next year. I think that's a rule that needs to come in. Big free throw here, because if he hits it, Georgetown really needs three possessions to get back in the lead or tie. Right now, 62-58, two possessions, you get 2 points. Each time down, you tie. He makes this one, then they need that third possession. Not a lot of time for three possessions.
And if he makes it, they can start the theme from Rocky in Philadelphia. Williams, Wingate.
Denson almost got the ball, but even better yet, he went and knocked it out of bounds so Georgetown couldn't keep it going. Got to waste some time now just to go ahead and get her in.
Jensen. Wingate comes back, regains possession for the Hoyas. He drives inside for the layup.
No timeouts left. They called Williams for holding McLean. That was a big foul there because 5 seconds were just about ready to be called. Now, as everybody realizes, Georgetown has no timeouts left. So if they score, that villain, they have no ability to stop this clock except by fouling.
McLean is 5 of 6 from the free throw line in this game. He was 5 of 7 from the field.
Well, you like to have seniors on the foul line at the end of the game. I think back in that NC State team, Brent, three seniors with a lot of experience carried out that big upset over Houston.
Jackson.
Now, Brent, Villanova, if they're smart, they cannot lose this game. For the simple reason that they can hold the ball out of bounds after the next two scores by Georgetown if they get down there, and there's no way Georgetown can stop the clock. They just have to get it inbound. There's a hold. Yep, two shots.
Rodnax with the intentional foul, and it is picked up that time. It was not earlier. Now Raleigh Massimino will use one of his remaining two timeouts to talk about how to handle the clock, how to handle the free throw situation here in the Rupp Arena.
And the man that they fouled intentionally, and it's about the only thing Georgetown can do, because as I pointed out, with 10 seconds on the clock, Villanova could just let the ball hang out of bounds the next two times they touch it, this game would be over. Now he takes that timeout. Presley will be on the foul line.
We'll be right back.
fellas to calm down and understand exactly the situation. Number one, do not commit any fouls. Allow Georgetown, if they have to go all the way to the basket, but do not foul them, give up a three-point play, or stop the clock. If you're friendly, again, he's been feast or famine on the foul line. Georgetown fouled the right man. Get two shots, which is always a lot easier to shoot than having to hit that front end of the one-on-one. The other thing I'm kind of surprised with Raleigh Massimino, that he doesn't go ahead and put a man bringing the ball up the court to make it a little more difficult to get the ball inbound.
Jackson, and there are just 5 seconds
game's
left.
Over.
There will be no dynasty. Villanova has done it.
Well, what happened? Georgetown did the only thing they could do. They knocked the ball out, and the referee had to stop the clock. Well, nice little trick by Georgetown. They could go ahead and try that. The referee had warned them once. They knocked it out, so the referee has to go do it. Go chase the ball down, and when he did, he stopped the clock.
And Villanova has moved to the brink of capturing this championship by blazing away at 79% from the floor. That, an NCAA tournament record.
What's incredible about that, Brent, they did it against a team that was holding opponents for the year and the NCAA tournament under 40%. Now, the key thing here for Villanova, one, they must get the ball inbounds within 5 seconds. That means it must touch a player from either team within 5 seconds. I think they've got to throw the ball up at least towards the half-court area. They cannot afford to throw that ball in under their own basket, because with 2 seconds to go, Georgetown can get a piece of it and put it back up. Let's see if Raleigh Massimino tries to get the ball up court. And in a jump ball situation, the ball would go to Villanova.
That's it. Villanova has done it.
will win its second straight. The Chevrolet most valuable players, Gary McLean of Villanova, and for Georgetown, David Wingate. And right now, let's go down to Brent Musburger. All right, Dick, thank you. All right, nobody thought they could do it.
No one thought we could do it, but I did. So did they. They played a great basketball game. I'm not even excited. It's April Fool's. This really didn't happen.
Did Georgetown win? April Fool's.
It ain't April Fool's. We won.
Ed Pinckney, you come in here as one of the senior spokesmen. Tell me how this was accomplished tonight. This team had beaten you twice. They were a heavy favorite against you. What did you do to win this game?
We just believed in ourselves and a lot of hard work on everybody's part. Not only a team, but, you know, the fans, they were all behind us. Everybody from Philadelphia, hello, New York City.
Eddie, you early in the game, you went right at Pat Ewing. You, in particular, said we're going to come right to the big fella tonight.
You can't be intimidated, not in a game like this. It's the last game of the year of my career, and I just have to play my hardest.
Hey, how about Gary? There's a statue in Philadelphia of a guy standing up on his fist. Tonight you were that guy playing in the backcourt against all that pressure. Incredible offensive performance on your part.
Oh, I just attribute it to all hard work. We work so hard. Nobody in America knows how Villanova works so hard. We do, and this is what happens when you work hard. You win, number one. You're number one.
Hey, here's your man, Jake David, coming up.
This was also for Al Simmons, the former coach, who passed away. Passed away today, and I think he was swatting them away when they made and missed some shots.
Dolly, let me ask you, over here at practice this morning, a couple of the players and your assistant coaches said we put in some new plays. What did you do differently against this team?
Well, we put in a couple of new sets in case they pressed us, and we worked right there at the end. That's what we're trying to do. It just worked well, and God was with us, and I love my mother and brother. I got to tell them, this is the greatest thing that happened to me.
Dolly, one of the other things I want to ask you, at the end of the first half, you had to take Eddie out. He had the two fouls on him.
Yeah, we held the ball.
Right, so you held the ball. Well, you had to be happy that John didn't come dead.
Oh, I was very happy. All I knew is we had to cross that 28-foot line. Or else we'd be the boss.
Fantastic down there. No question. We are
the one. One more senior, and then we're going to go up the deck. Dwayne McLean, you started out hot tonight. You were blazing away. Tell me what your thoughts were and how this team handled this enormous pressure.
Well, I knew if we could throw the tip of the game, it would be in our favor. ESPN had that second game on earlier, and we watched that, and it really inspired us. I think Gary played an excellent game. I thank God for this one.
What a great shot. Come on, Villanova. Let us go upstairs to Dick Stockton.
You'll get a city tonight, not a ring.
Thank you very much, Brent. And the Villanova Wildcats avoided a series of minefields to win this championship, starting with Dayton on the road. And then they beat Michigan, the top-seeded team in the Southeast. They beat North Carolina. There's John Thompson going up to get his trophy. He didn't win two in a row, but he is a great coach. And Raleigh Massimino brought his team against the toughest competition you can imagine. He beat North Carolina, came to Lexington, and beat Memphis State, and of course Georgetown, the top-seeded team, and Raleigh's got a title. We'll be back to Rupp Arena in just a moment. Well, Villanova has won, and here are the guys that did a superb job calling the game. And Billy Packer, when you said before the game, boy, the memory of NC State stands out in my mind. You were prophetic.
I never thought lightning would strike twice, but this is what makes college basketball the great game that it is. It was a sensational performance by a gritty bunch of kids.
Brent, could you imagine, here's a team that has allowed 39% shooting, and Villanova sets an all-time shooting record. Who can figure that?
It is a tribute to the senior leadership on that Villanova team, as well as the coach. Raleigh Massimino, again, Dick, did a superb job.
When John Thompson went into the four corners, do you think it was premature at that time?
No, I really didn't. I thought he was in the driver's seat and he could pull Villanova out. But the one thing that's so difficult, when you're playing against an underdog like Villanova and you put it in the four corners, he says, hey, I'm thankful to be just one down with you. I'll let some clock go off. And in that particular case, Georgetown turned it over.
Brent, could you sense in the second half, or at what point did you think Villanova gained a world of confidence?
I think that at the end of the half, when Reggie Williams came up with the forearms on Everson and no foul was called and Wally Massimino took him into the locker room with that lead, I think that they grouped together and they said, we can take it to them. We beat them in the first half and we can do it here in the second half. Let's go get them.
And they did it. The Villanova Wildcats are champions. The 1985 NCAA titleists for Brent Musburger and Billy Packer. Dick Stockton saying so long from Lexington. Now some a moment.
No one had enough credit given to the Villanova program, a program designed and crafted by Rolly Massimino, a man who, as I mentioned in the introduction moments ago, knows all about discipline, about how to play your kind of basketball game, about how to move the ball around and find the guy inside, in that case, Harold Presley. And believe me, this is a good Villanova team, and this is a good Georgetown team, so it was an up-and-down battle. Harold Jensen there, answering Georgetown. But then Georgetown goes inside to the big guy, Patrick Ewing, and you see that kind of action there. Here we are at the end of the half, Nova down by one. Presley puts him up by one. And in the second half, Nova does not seem fatigued at all. If anything, they are energized, even though their starters were in the game almost the entire way. Outside, inside, they did it all. And then here, we see it all coming down to the final seconds. When the ball goes up in the air and the jumping begins, Villanova has defeated Georgetown 66-64. The Wildcats are the national champions. And I thought it was very touching there that at the very end there, Rolly Massimino mentioned Jake Nevin, the longtime trainer who we see on the bench in the wheelchair, and the late Al Severance, a coach at Villanova who was a legend and passed away this morning of a heart attack. Typical of the class of Rolly Massimino and everyone at Villanova that they would think of people like Nevin and the late, great Al Severance at a moment of great joy.
Mainline tonight is not the most tranquil place in the Delaware Valley. Elliot Rodriguez is there live amidst his own celebration. Elliot, give it a try, Elliot.
You can hear me, but there is pure bedlam here in Villanova. I'm standing outside the Villanova Fieldhouse. Before this game was over, there was almost nobody out here. The minute that final buzzer sounded, we got hundreds of people. As far as I know, there may be more because I can't see anybody. There's just so many people. People started running out of buildings, out of dormitories, packing into the university. And here they are. I don't know if I can
I didn't hear a word either, but the picture tells...
Washington, they're celebrating on the main line, and the celebration will not end tonight. Tomorrow, the city of Philadelphia will honor the Wildcats with a victory parade. That parade is planned for 10:30 tomorrow morning. It will begin at 20th and JFK Boulevard. At 12:20, the parade will end at JFK Plaza, where the city will honor the Cats with a special ceremony.
Vindication for Villanova. It is the Cinderella story of 1985 as the Wildcats play David to the Goliath of Georgetown to become the 1985 champions of college basketball. What a night in the Delaware Valley. The Villanova Wildcats have defied the odds, and they've gone the distance tonight. They are the number one team in the nation. Our team coverage begins live in Lexington, Kentucky, where Joe Pellegrino is with the Wildcats live. He's been with them most of the week, Joe. They were 9-point underdogs. They went on to win. Very tough competition. They are the number one team.
I saw it. I'm not sure I believe it. It was unbelievable as the Villanova Wildcats kept coming back. I thought when Patrick Ewing scored three jams in a row that they were not probably going to come back. But you know what they did? They kept scoring a basket, coming back. Probably one of the keys was they scored a bucket to go in with the lead at halftime. That had to be a tremendous boost for them. They scored 72% from the floor, had a one-point lead in the first half. Guess what they shot in the second half? 79% from the floor total, meaning they shot over 80% from the floor in the second half. It's a tournament record. I've seen the miracle. They caught the lightning in the bottle tonight. They beat one of the greatest basketball teams in history. Georgetown, without a doubt, is one of the classic teams, man for man, have more talent than Villanova. But they didn't have the experience, apparently, the tournament savvy when they really needed it, because whatever Villanova was asked to do, they did it. Harold Jensen came down, hit a jump shot with 2:33 left, put them ahead by 1 point. It was a magnificent victory. I think all of the Delaware Valley is probably topsy-turvy if you like basketball just a little bit. We'll be back later on. We'll try to have some guests, some Nova fans, some Georgetown fans, if they're going to talk to us, and we'll see you in a little while.
We just saw a glimpse of it, Joe, in the very beginning. There is a lot of celebration here in the Delaware Valley. They're calling it a Cinderella finish, but a lot of hard work went into this win tonight for Villanova and the Wildcats. Thanks, Joe. Well, tonight, the focal point for the Delaware Valley's victory celebration is the Villanova campus, and Suzanne Bates, she is there live right now with a party, I guess you can say, has just begun. Suzanne?
Well, Alan, we have absolute pandemonium on the campus of Villanova tonight. Students are pouring out of the dorms, and you can hear the chants behind me. It's just deafening. I'm going to try to talk to a few of the students and see what they have to say. What's your name?
Mark Walsh.
What do you think about this? Can you believe it?
It's going to be a lifetime experience. It'll be a lifetime experience. The best experience I'll ever have at Villanova.
Definitely. Thanks a lot. We don't want to create a mob scene out here, so we're going to cut it short, Alan. But I can tell you, the students here absolutely can't believe it. They are so proud of the Wildcats tonight, and they have every reason to be.
All right, Suzanne, thank you. I'm Chris Long along Lancaster Avenue, just off campus. I'll tell you, we have a mob scene out here right now. Let's move that camera down. But so far, I can report the students are enjoying themselves, but really behaving themselves rather well so far. This is just away from Kelly's Bar, which is a very, very popular off-campus drinking spot, and about 400 jam Kellys throughout the game to watch it. They poured out of here shortly after the seconds ticked off in the big Villanova victory, and as you can see, they are having quite a time. They're on top of each other's shoulders. They are hollering and screaming and holding up signs, but again, behaving themselves fairly well so far. I am counting about 30 Lower Merion police officers on the scene right now. The cars, perhaps you can see behind me, are streaming solidly one after one up and down Lancaster Avenue. So far, though, the students behaving themselves well. Let's take you back now just a few hours ago and take a look at some of these security measures that were put in force for tonight's game. Just about an hour before game time tonight, 60 Pennsylvania State Police officers arrived on Villanova's campus, some from barracks as far away as Bethlehem. They assembled in the university's field house and began their wait, ready to back up school security on campus if needed. At the beginning of the game, the few officers who really seemed interested had to rely on a radio broadcast.
Arms waving. Gary gets a tightening top of the key.
But Villanova officials soon proved better hosts and came up with a television set. Outside Kelly's Bar just off campus, an overflow crowd of young fans had to be content with viewing the game through the window. Simply no more room inside. In typical college fashion, the beer was flowing tonight. Bar manager T.C. Biggins saying he really stocked up for the evening.
We probably laid in three times as much as we usually do. The beer delivery place had to make two trips out.
All right, a fan here just handed me a basketball net, and I guess that's appropriate tonight here. Once again, the students behaving themselves fairly well. The police seem to have everything in hand. I would heartily advise you, though, to avoid this area of Lancaster Avenue in Bryn Mawr unless you really need to be here tonight. We'll check in back again a little bit later. This is Chris Long, live, reporting from just off campus. Alan?
Okay, Chris, they have a good reason to celebrate, and as we mentioned earlier, the celebration has only just begun. There is no better time to witness the pure unbridled joy of the winning team than right after the game. Let's take a look.
Oh, no one thought we could do it, but I did, and so did they. They played a great basketball game. I'm not even excited. I think it's really
we just believed in ourselves and a lot of hard work on everybody's part. Not only a team, but, you know, the fans, they were all behind us. Everybody from Philadelphia, hello.
There's a statue in Philadelphia of a guy standing up holding his fist. Tonight, you were that guy playing in the backcourt against all that pressure. Incredible offensive performance on your part.
Oh, I just attribute it to all hard work. We worked so hard. Nobody in America knows how Villanova worked so hard.
Lots of hard work. And those are the thoughts. Rolly Massimino, the coach of the Villanova Wildcats, his players, some of the fans. Big Al Meltzer is here right now to share his thoughts tonight.
Well, Alan, it wasn't supposed to happen, but it did. The team that couldn't shoot straight set an NCAA record for shooting from the field. The team that had to play Dayton, Maryland, Michigan, North Carolina, Memphis State, Georgetown, and needed their best game ever to win, did it. The team seeded eighth in their regional, unranked, did it. The team that had already lost to Georgetown twice this year did it. Villanova had never won an NCAA championship before. They've gotten to the finals. They've done the impossible. Never mind the polls or what the experts think. Where it counts is that the Wildcats and their emotional leader, Rolly Massimino, are number one. They did it for Al Severance, who passed on today, a 25-year coach. They did it for Jake Nevin. They did it for Villanova. They did it for Philadelphia. They are truly number one, Villanova, the champions of all of college basketball. And we couldn't...
Victory will be shared by the entire Delaware Valley tomorrow. As we said, the celebrations have just begun. The city of Philadelphia has scheduled a victory parade around City Hall. It begins at 12 noon with ceremonies afterward at JFK Plaza. You'll see it live right here on Channel 10. But tonight, after our news broadcast, we'll present a special salute to the Wildcats, a look back at Villanova's 1984-85 season. That's tonight, right after the Channel 10 news update. Tonight, he'll show you how the Hoyas lost. The Wildcats, the best college basketball team in the nation, have returned to a triumphant welcome celebration. They were tired of course, but very happy as they climbed off their plane at International Airport this morning. Then they were whisked away to Center City, Philadelphia, and thousands of adoring fans. A lot of jubilation and celebration in the Delaware Valley. We have team coverage tonight as Wildcat fever swirls around the Delaware Valley. First, Ruggles, who is right in the middle of the big parade through Center City.
You couldn't get close to the podium at JFK Plaza. Thousands of Villanova students and basketball fans formed a sea of supporters cheering the team that did what many thought impossible. There was music, there were cheers, as Philadelphia took time to say, job well done.
Who is number one? Who is number one? Who is number one?
It was an emotional high that fed on itself. Amid all the happy hysteria, there was some confusion. Mayor Good, out of town on business, tried to send his well wishes by telephone, just as Villanova's president was thanking the city for the red carpet.
We're not getting a good level. All right, now we got you.
Few could hear, and most didn't care, because today, the good mayor took a back seat to a great team. And the only time the crowd got quiet was when Rolly Massimino took the microphone.
It's really a pleasure and an honor for me
and our team to be the national champions of the nation!
And as been his custom the entire tournament, the Italian leprechaun quickly turned the spotlight on his players.
They deserved it. They did it. They shot 79%.
For each player, it was a personal triumph. But the team wanted to share the glory with everyone.
There wasn't anybody in the country but all you people that could believe that we could do it, and we did it. And Villanova's number one!
Call them Cinderellas or a team of destiny. Today, it made no difference. Today, thousands are calling this group their team because they've made the Delaware Valley proud. Terry Ruggles, Channel 10 News, Center City.
It was Villanova's day in the sun. The parade started at 20th and JFK, and for a few hours, everyone was a Villanova fan.
Villanova!
They came to praise the Cinderella team from all walks of life, from up high and down low. The theme was the same, you're number one. This is truly a Philadelphia happening. It is not just a Villanova parade. Many of the people that are here are from other Big Five schools, but they're here today praising the Cats, and that is a story in itself. Where did you graduate from?
LaSalle.
And you're here rooting Villanova on.
Absolutely.
Raising the enemy.
They're not the enemy. I think they're great. Doing a lot for the city.
I think I owe it to the city and to the Delaware Valley to root for the Delaware Valley zone, you know?
Even though you're from St. Joseph's University, or the college as it used to be called, huh?
I'm going to take a lot of ribbing from my buddies from Villanova, but it's worth it.
But it was also a big day for the Nova students, who were decked out in blue and white, cat's paws, V's on their faces, and joy in their hearts. There were streamers in the air along with the accolades, and there was also a new tree blooming in downtown Philadelphia, which sprouted Villanova fans from every branch. Tell me about Raleigh Massimino. How do people perceive him?
I think he looks like Louie from Taxi, but he's a hell of a coach.
A lot of people are probably wondering why so much attention for a sporting event. Maybe the answer is this simple. What Villanova did was right out of Walter Mitty. They had a team that wasn't that good, but with hard work, determination, and teamwork, they won it all. It epitomized the true American values. Bill Baldini, Channel 10.
Operation then moved from Center City to the campus of Villanova University. That right now is where Casey Kaufman is to report on the special welcome the team got from perhaps their best fans. Casey?
Well, that's right, Chris. The Center City Parade was just the beginning of an enthusiastic homecoming that stretched all the way to the Villanova campus, a homecoming that stretched out throughout the day. A crowd of screaming fans met the new NCAA champions as they arrived back on the Villanova campus this afternoon. Forward Harold Presley summed up the sentiments of his teammates.
How does it feel to be back home on campus?
It's wonderful. It's a treat always to come back to these people. You know, they're always giving us a warm welcome. We just love them so much.
There were high fives all around and autographs and hats to sign as the students and fans of all ages welcomed the Wildcats home in a spontaneous pep rally behind the field house.
This is something I don't think I'll ever experience again. It's been great. Love it!
The atmosphere on campus was festive as cars cruised Lancaster Avenue. Students bought their championship t-shirts and broke into the impromptu chant that's become the call of the Wildcats.
Nova, Nova, Nova!
During the afternoon, van and carloads full of Wildcats supporters rolled into campus after the 12-hour drive from Kentucky. And judging by the looks and sounds of things, the party isn't over yet.
The most incredible road trip of our lives.
And the basketball is great. Yeah.
Good land, good soil, good people.
Great. Most incredible road trip of our lives.
And the celebration continues. Late this afternoon, the White House called and invited the whole team to come to Washington, D.C. on Thursday to meet with President Reagan. Of course, it's up to the coach to determine whether or not the team will make that trip, and we will keep you informed. Back to you in the studio.
Still a lot of celebration at Villanova, and why not? They're basking in victory. Thanks for a big game better than Raleigh Massimino. Joe Pellegrino was with the team in Lexington all weekend. He caught up with the exhausted Villanova coach on today's return flight to Philadelphia.
When Georgetown's fans showed up last night, it was just to be another game, another victory for the championship. What Cinderella team? Don't dream the impossible dream, right? Wrong. The Wildcats had something else in mind. They would not accommodate the Hoyas. And the Villanova fans had plenty of support among the Villanova partisan Rupp Arena crowd. Harold Presley's battling bucket to take the 29-28 halftime lead. Harold Jensen's jumper with 2:37 left to reclaim the lead for the last time. An ultimate victory.
That's it. Villanova has done it.
After a night of celebration, the bleary-eyed official party boarded the joyous but quiet plane ride home. No boisterous celebration here, but that wonderful, weary feeling of accomplishment.
Does it feel just as good right now as it did last night?
Yes, I'm just really tired, Joe. It's just starting to hit me, but I'm really excited, and it's just a wonderful thing, as I said to everyone that we talked to. It's great.
They played the perfect game for you, didn't they?
Yes, they really did. They shot the ball well. They defended immaculately. I mean, it was a clinic, I thought.
And now we will show you your champions as you have probably never seen them before. Dwayne McLean on the right and Conley Brown. Gary McLean. Dwight Wilbur on the left and Brian Harrington. Mark Plansky.
Isn't that wonderful? We would have shot all of them, of course, but we didn't want to embarrass too many of them. But gentlemen, sleep well tonight. You earned it. And congratulations on being the champions number one.
Joe, you sleep well, too. You earned it.
Yeah.
Busy time. Thank
you. I'm going to see you in a while. Okay.
Today's celebrating in Center City was the finale of a week of Wildcat madness on the Villanova campus. Suzanne Bates was right in the middle of it all last night, just as the Villanova campus erupted into celebration.
Just as the Wildcats outplayed the Hoyas last night, they showed they could outparty them, too. Traffic was stopped on Lancaster Avenue as thousands of students poured into the streets.
What Georgetown said, you know, they said all along that they were going to win it. I'm just glad we won it and showed them right back.
Chase.
Parties on campus began in the dorms. And then the victory celebration moved outside. The first ever NCAA championship celebration for Villanova was as incredible as the victory itself. What do you think this has done for Villanova's image?
I think it's going to increase the popularity of the school. It's going to show people that we are, you know, a competitive school throughout the nation. I think it's going to do a really good job to help build up the school spirit.
It's safe to say there has never been a party quite like this on the campus of Villanova University. The Wildcats are number one, and tonight is a night they'll always remember. Suzanne Bates, Channel 10 News.
Number one and enjoying every minute of it. And Channel 10 coverage of the 1985 champion Villanova Wildcats continues with more, of course, from Al Meltzer and Joe Pellegrino later in Live at 5. Then, at 6 o'clock, how the big win makes big money for Villanova and a profile of team member Gary McLean. And tonight, right after the Channel 10 News update, a special report on today's victory parade for the Wildcats in Center City, Philadelphia, as the Delaware Valley honors the new college champs.
Cat Magic has moved all the way to Washington, D.C. today.
It certainly has. Villanova's national champions are being honored by President Reagan himself. And Channel 3's Jerry Pinacoli is live with the story. Jerry, what excitement.
Pat, I'll tell you, what a day here in Washington when the Villanova Wildcats took the Georgetown Hoyas on Monday night.
They became instant celebrities. Everybody wanted a piece of them, including the President of the United States. He invited the team, the coaches, led by, of course, Coach Raleigh Massimino, and an entire entourage from the main line down to Washington, to the Rose Garden. Now, the President was supposed to meet with the President of Colombia, but he has to wait. The Villanova Wildcats come first in the President's book today.
His victory was also a bittersweet one. It was long, hard hours of preparation that enabled you to capture the championship. As Gary McLean said, we worked so hard for this, no one in America knows how hard we worked. This is what can happen when you really work hard. And, Rolly, you deserve a great deal of credit for that preparation and also for everything you've done to turn a group of tremendous individual players into a team that will go down in the history books. This is your day. You know the people of Philadelphia are proud of you. Your families are proud of you. And today I just want you to know that all of your countrymen join your family and friends in applauding your achievements. So God bless each one of you, and thank you very much for being here.
Friends, this is really a pleasure. In fact, I'm probably more nervous than you saw all of us running up and down that bench during the course of that Georgetown game. But even though you're a Hoya fan, we would like to make you an honorary Wildcat.
That was Raleigh Massimino, and of course a very, very proud man this afternoon. Yes, President Reagan did admit that he is a Hoya fan, but that he will indeed be a Wildcat fan today and maybe for a long time to come. That's it from the White House in Washington. I'm Jerry Penicoli. Back to you in Philadelphia.